So it's a real pleasure to be able to be joining Ellison Fine Arts, Over the Influence, and White Cube in their galleries and to see what's happening. I think Hong Kong, Lake Taipei, is a city that has been less hard hit recently. The galleries tend to have continued programming, even if they took some time off. So I do hope we'll be able to hear from the galleries a little bit about what they've been doing, how their programming has been responding, and what the next steps are. So without further ado, I'd like to hand it over to Shannon at Ellison Fine Arts. And I look forward to seeing what you have on.
Thank you. So good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Ellison Fine Arts in Hong Kong. I'm Shannon Hubert, and I'm here today with my gallery director, Daphne King.
Hi, everyone. 大家好. I'm so glad that you're all here to join us on our live stream tour and our talk this afternoon. Today, we're going to introduce you to our gallery, Ellison Fine Arts, and as well as give you a walk around, a tour of our current exhibition of Ineffable Garden. It's a joint show between two internationally known Chinese artists, Sun Dunjin and Barbara Edelstein. We have around 20 minutes together, maybe 15. So hopefully we can maybe keep the questions till the end, and we'll have some time to answer them just so that we can keep the flow going.
那么下面我们的画廊的主理人 Daphne King 将会给大家讲一下我们现在正在中环画廊展出的展览，由国际知名艺术家张建军跟 Barbara Edelstein 带来的《幻缘》。那在此之前呢，也想要向大家介绍一下画廊的历史。如果你有任何问题的话，我们之后会非常乐意为您解答。那明年其实是艺昌画廊 Ellison Fine Arts 成立的第40周年。 那 Daphne， 你能跟我们讲一下，介绍一下早期的画廊。Yes,
So I can't believe that we're actually going to be celebrating our 40th anniversary next year. Time really flies. I remember having a big celebration at our 35th anniversary when we published a huge monologue on our gallery history. So next year it's going to be 40 years. And yes, and originally, in 1981, when Ellison Fine Arts was first established, the art scene here, particularly in Hong Kong, was completely different. There were only a few galleries, and most of them focused on antiquity. We were probably one of the first galleries here to start focusing on Chinese contemporary art. And we're looking at the totality of the ecosystem. Sotheby's had just started several years before that in the late 70s. And Christie's had not even started their first auction yet. And that wouldn't happen for another 5 years or so. And definitely art fairs, they did not exist during that time. So yeah, the art scene was completely different from how we know it today.
对，没错。那现在的香港、台湾、新加坡，甚至是中国大陆的话， 艺术环境甚至是或者是亚洲其他的地方的话，跟以前来相比是非常不同的。 那 Daphne， 你能跟大家介绍一下，就早期画廊带领的一些艺术家吗？
So in the early years, when the gallery first started, we were promoting mainly Chinese diaspora artists, and this first group of artists who left China in the 1940s and settled overseas. Some of them in Taiwan, some of them went to Europe, and some of them went to the U.S. To Paris and New York. These artists included Zhao Tunxiang, Zhuang Jie, Zhao Wuji, Zhu Dechun, and Wallace Ting. And at that time, we felt it was particularly important to promote these artists because while they might have established themselves in their new home country, they were actually relatively unknown here in Asia, although those names that I mentioned just now are probably most of you are quite familiar with them now. During that time, they were not. And even as late as 1993, when we held the first solo exhibition for Zhao Wuji in Hong Kong, it was the first commercial show ever for Zhao Wuji. We had a really hard time convincing collectors of the importance of Zhao Wuji. Can you believe that?
没错，艺昌画廊1993年第一次为赵无极在香港举办个展的时候，亚洲的藏家们对他还所知甚少。那在过去这20年之后，他的作品现在可以就是 达到数百万美元。那除了赵无极之外，早期的画家易昌画廊，还能给大家再介绍一下吗？
好的。Besides the Chinese diaspora artists, we obviously also focused on artists from Hong Kong, since that's where our gallery is based. And one of these important artists include Wu Shouquan. He is known as the founder of the New Ink Art Movement. Actually, we are continuing to work with all those artists that I just mentioned, as well as Wu Shouquan. But then later in the 1980s, when China started to open up some more, we held in 1987 the first exhibition in Hong Kong, one of the first exhibitions in Hong Kong that promoted mainland Chinese artists. And most of them we focused on artists who were working in the Chinese media. And now currently we are very much focused on that stream of working with contemporary ink. And many of these artists are now, you know, have received international recognition. They include artists such as Wang Tianze, Zhang Yu, Wei Lidong, and Nan Xi, and some other artists that have now left mainland China and have moved overseas. Those artists include like Bao Xingjian, who left in the 80s, as well as Yang Jiechang.
So, Yichang画廊的主要关注的 点呢是海外的华人艺术家跟水墨艺术家。So actually, in fact, our current show here for artist Zhang Jianjing is a perfect example. So he's a Chinese artist who's from Shanghai, who graduated from the Shanghai Theatre Academy's Department of Fine Arts. And in 1987, after receiving a grant from the Rockefeller Foundation, also known as Asian Cultural Council, he went to New York and moved there in 1989. So now he travels and lives in between the two cities, New York and Shanghai, and teaches at NYU with Barbara Adelstein. Our gallery started working with him since 1987, being one of the first shows that highlighted mainland Chinese artists in Hong Kong.
Yes, and so Zhang Jianjing is also known as a multimedia artist. He has really remained true to the ink medium. And we're gonna go over here now and show you some of the work in this exhibition. So in particular, I wanted to first start off with this piece of this sculpture by Zhang Jianjing. It's a sculpture, an object that is quite common and is found in the Lunavati gardens in the olden days in China. I want to start with this one in particular because it is showing how he's still working with Chinese ink medium, even though it's a sculptural 3D object. He's using ink painting with multimedia and some rice paper mixed in. So although it is now 3D, it is very much still rooted in the tradition. This particular work, in fact, was commissioned by the Brooklyn Museum for their reopening of their Asian galleries. So the first edition of this piece is currently on display in New York at the museum. And this one is number 8 of 8.
那除了在布鲁克林美术馆之外呢，在2008年美国纽约大都会博物馆呢举办的展览当中呢，张建军也带来了他的硅胶制作的同样的一个奇石的雕塑。
Yeah. So speaking of Zhang Jianjing's silicon rock that was found at Metz during the big art exhibition, over here we have another silicon work that is actually by Barbara Edelstein. These larger than life leaves and brightly colored works, not unlike the colors that Zhang Jianjing uses for his silicon works. So as the title of this exhibition is Ineffable Garden, it focuses on different forms of nature. Shannon, do you think you would like to, maybe we should bring our audience around and we can have a look at the different artworks?
Yeah, sure. That are here. From 那张建军他其实一直以来都对水非常大的迷恋，
那他认为水是一个永恒的感觉，那也是所有生命的开始。那这幅画里面呢，他将墨油彩跟塑胶彩一起创造出这样一种水在律动跟流动的感觉。在宣纸上的话，加上它是在宣纸上，所以它的 texture 感觉整个就是有一种水在流动的感觉。
So while Shannon was explaining this work of Flowing Water series, we have, I would like to actually focus on another piece of work that also is reflecting this water. And this one here is known as Rubbing, it's from the Rubbing Rain series. And I decided to choose this piece because, well, I find it particularly attractive. I also like how he has used the different medium, the Eastern and the Western medium, to combine a piece of work and create something that I feel is really in perfect harmony. So for example, you can see here on the left side, he is using acrylic on canvas. And here on the right side, he has applied a piece of Chinese rice paper and used ink on top. And still, you know, is able to create the depth and the texture that we find here. And I'm also particularly fond of this cobalt blue color that he has used. So here there are a few other works. We can just pan quickly, we won't talk too much about them, but you can have a look at the First Drop of Rain series. And then this is also, again, the Rubbing Rain, but in a smaller format.
So in talk about the water, the very essence of the nature world, we can look back to the nature created by Albert Einstein.
So as we can see here, Barbara focuses on leaves, as we mentioned before, the larger than like silicon leaves. Here she has created leaves with ink, ink on Western paper, not rice paper. And she combines it together with the, or hangs it together with the photo. Which is a Western medium. The works don't necessarily need to be hung together per se, but I find that it creates a nice, you know, they echo each other and they create a nice union. And I really love the way that she's, you know, worked with the ink here and brought out the veins of the leaves. And you really can kind of feel the essence of nature.
Barbara Epstein, 她作为一个美国人呢，她从小生长家中的家庭呢，也是一个很受东方思想影响的一个家庭，所以说她这个把西方的媒介和中国的传统的中国艺术结合在一起呢，也是她非常就是对于她的 Zen 一个禅宗思想的一个思考。
I just looked at my watch and I think we need to speed talk because we don't actually have that much time left, but perhaps we can slowly pan some of the works here. And here she also works in video art.
We're running out short of the time, and maybe we can introduce a bit more about our artist who put on our online viewing room.
Yeah, so before we go, we also just wanted to show you in person the works that are on the online viewing room. We'll start first here with Wallace Ting. He is probably someone that most of you are quite familiar with. He's known for his brightly colored nude women. And here we have a perfect example of these two sultry looking ladies that are very typical of his paintings.
Wallace Ting 也是丁雄泉，也是我们画廊一直合作，并且很早就开始合作的一位艺术家。我们线上展览的作品呢，也都是从他的家族。
And next to Wallace Ting, actually on top, and next to we have Chao Chun Chang, who was a contemporary with Ting. He left China in the 1940s and eventually settled in New York and worked together with Wallace Ting. They were kind of frenemies. And you can see that their treatment of the work is really quite different, although there might be some similarities in terms of the pop color that they're using. He has remained true to Chinese tradition a bit more in terms of the subject matter that he uses.
那赵春祥呢，在台湾的收藏家当中，据我所知是很受欢迎的。那他曾经就读于杭州国立艺术专科学校， 是从于林凤年，那同时也是朱德群跟赵文琪的母校。台中的亚洲大学现代美术馆的去年也刚举办了一场他的回顾展。也因为藏家们对他的热情很高，所以其实在市场上他的非常好的作品其实很少见。
So, the next panel we have here is works by another Chinese American artist who spent quite a lot of time in Taiwan, so you probably should be familiar with his work too. This is Song Zhongjie. He was one of the founders of the Fifth Moon Group, and this particular work was done in 1989.He currently lives in New York, and I went to a studio to select this work recently.
庄杰也是我们特别早就开始合作的艺术家，也是在画廊创办第二年，1982年就开始和我们合作。那他的创作的话，可以看到就是非常的将中国的传统艺术跟西方的前卫艺术结合起来，创造这种比较抽象的感觉。
Yeah, and next to Zhang Jie is another artist from Taiwan, Yu Tuyi. He's known for his rubbing and stamp method of paintings.
李俊毅他是新水墨运动的重要的人物。那他在木块上刻的这些中国字做的印章呢，给大家带来一种有点像诗的一种感觉。那现在李俊毅除了继续创作之外呢，还是一名国立台湾艺术大学和师范大学的老师。那我们接下来最后的两位艺术家。
Last two panels here, we have Gao Xinjian, who is a not only an artist, but he is also a poet, an author, and a Nobel laureate. And he is known for his black and white atmospheric Chinese ink paintings.
那高行健他也非常多才多艺，除了创绘画之外呢，他还有创作戏剧。那我们也是跟他从1994年开始就开始合作，那至今为止也为他举办了八个个展。
And last but not least, here we have Zhu Zhu, who is a emerging young female artist from Guangzhou. Her work here that we're showing is a larger than life gardenia painting, photograph actually, with calligraphy.So also like Barbara, she, you know, marries the two different types of media. We recently placed her work at the Philadelphia Museum of Art in the U.S.
那楚楚她是获得了一个书法的博士学位，所以可以看出她在创作当中有很大的影响。那因为她用了很传统的书法，水墨创造这种非常现代的东西，所以我个人觉得非常有趣。
Okay, I think we are almost done, and maybe we're going to open the floor for questions or...Should we
talk about a bit about the COVID-19?
Yes, because I think probably people might be interested in learning or hearing what we have to say. I think the virus at this time obviously has affected many, many art institutions. Art fairs have postponed or canceled. Auction houses also postponed or canceled some of their sales. And museums have closed down, galleries have closed down. Luckily,For us in Hong Kong and particularly Allison Fine Arts, we have remained open during this entire time. But of course, the flow of people coming into our gallery has really slowed down. But we have instead beefed up our online presence. We are going to be launching our WeChat account next week. So for those of you who are on WeChat, please look out for us. We also started a Twitter account, and we are also...posting every single day on Instagram and Facebook. So hopefully you're already following us. If you're not, please look us up and start to follow us.
对，所以我们也是想要加强我们自己在线上的一个存在。所以除了我们各种的社交媒体之外，我们也参加这次的直播，然后也是希望跟各个藏家还有各个的画廊也是保持一个非常好的关系。
Yeah, so I'm not sure how much time we have left. Next year probably is not going to be an easy year for all of us, but it's, given us time as a gallery to relook at how we are going to, connect and continue to connect with audiences like you yourselves who are logged into our live stream session today.
希望大家继续关注艺昌画廊，也是希望大家继续关注和支持台北当代。
Yeah, so I'm not sure if there's any time for questions, but if there are, we are happy to answer any of them. Oh, that was
very
fast.
Thank you very much for taking us through the gallery. That was really wonderful. I especially love seeing the pull-out inventory in the back room there. I don't see any questions coming in on my end here. If we have anything else coming in, we will pass along. We can answer them a little bit later. But that is a good reminder. Anybody who's listening, if you do have questions, please feel free, if you're on Zoom, to use the Q&A function. If you're on Facebook, to just post them in the comments. And we will hand them over to the panelists and make sure that they can get to them in a timely fashion. Thank you very much. That was really wonderful. Next, we are getting ready to hand over to Over the Influence, where Juliana is going to walk us through the gallery. I'm really excited today. The three galleries we have in Hong Kong, I think, are very indicative of the variety, the breadth of programming that we do get to see in Hong Kong, which is really exciting from a more kind of contemporary take on traditional aesthetics and now to a more pop or street forward look at contemporary art today. So Juliana, over to you.
Hi, thank you for joining us today on live streaming with Taipei Connections, and thank you Robin and the team for creating this opportunity. I hope everyone who is watching or listening is finds them healthy and safe. I'll start off with giving a brief introduction of the gallery, and then we will give you a quick walkthrough of our most recent exhibition, which is on view right now. Over the Influence was found in Hong Kong in 2015. We are a fairly new gallery. In 2018, we opened our second space in Los Angeles Arts District. And most recently, last month in April, we opened our second space in Hong Kong, which is just downstairs of our current gallery. And we feel very lucky and grateful that we were able to expand our gallery here in Hong Kong during these times. It's a sign of our commitment towards the local art community here in Hong Kong and in the region. So today here, we're at the newest location, our newly expanded gallery here in Hong Kong. I'm going to walk you through our inaugural exhibition of this gallery space. We decided to open with a group show called Rise and Shine. We wanted to put together a show that would kind of, I think, encourage positivity and lightness during these uncertain times that we've been facing the last few months, especially here in Hong Kong with the protests from last year and, of course, this global crisis of the coronavirus. So if you'll walk with me, so this group show called Rise and Shine, we included around 11 artists. It also includes around four artists that we are showing for the first time at our gallery. Our gallery is dedicated to working with emerging as well as established artists who, I would say, challenge the traditional approaches of traditional artist studio practice. Many of these artists explore the intersections of different disciplinaries, such as contemporary art, design, fashion, music, and other visual expressions. So the first artist that I'd like to highlight is Eric Parker. Eric, as you can see here, the show will focus on a lot of colorful and playful artworks. Eric is one of the artists that we recently started working with. His visual freestyle works combine elements of contemporary culture into a narrative flow of politics, music, internet memes, hallucinatory dreams, conspiracy theories, and it's packed with references of various subcultures. He explores today's familiar feeling of, I think, society through a cacophony of visual sources. This is what we call one of his landscape imaginary series. Eric Parker has shown, you know, with Honor Fraser, with Mary Boone in New York, and I'm now here with us in Hong Kong. And in this specific series, we would call it an imaginary landscape, combining colors that are very bright and neon.
it's a stark contrast to older works that he worked on before that have a little bit of more of a trippy aspect to it. This is more of a calm, it reflects his phase in his life where I think he has found more stability and like family values and things like that. It's harder to explain because his older works are a lot more jarring, I would say. So this is more like a peaceful landscape among his avoir. And then we have Gosha Liboshkin, who is a young artist that we have just started working with. Gosha is in this, I would say in this specific painting, Gosha is representing again, a hangout of friends or figures that we do not know really. They've been stripped of their any distinct features except their sex. Gosha is best known for his larger scale acrylic works in the tradition of ligne clair, which is like a French technique that you see in comics such as Tintin. His works usually represent the harmonious interactions of subjects who naturally dismissing the bounds of cultural boundaries and are able to overcome and adapt to complicated situations. Here we see like a peaceful, you know, hangout, but we don't know if it's peaceful. We see fire here and, you know, we see elements of water and flower. And, you know, it makes the viewers kind of question what kind of scene they're trying, what they're doing, whether it's swimming or playing. And then next, I'd like to show a painting by Leroy Neiman. Leroy Neiman is an artist who passed away in 2012. He is known for blending a pop art sensibility with fauvist yet expressionistic brushwork. He relentlessly depicted subjects from basketball stars to American politicians to sprawling English gardens. His paintings and prints have been featured in magazines and commercially shown internationally. His works are also collected by museums, including the Art Institute of Chicago, the Smithsonian, American Art Museum in DC, among others. He has a fascination with famous people and especially sports stars. And here in this specific painting, we see Kobe Bryant, which we thought was relevant, of course, you know, given the news of his death this year. And then we will continue on to our next room. So this is a painting by Johnny Cheatwood, another young US-based artist. Oh, by the way, this show is comprised of of artists who have practices in the US. Johnny Cheatwood begins his paintings with direct marks and squiggles, which he reacts and builds the compositions over time. The graffiti-like scribbles and scratches and primitive colors are the controlled, chaotic work of an expressionist. He also plays with the balance between unpredictability and control, abstract and figuration, and painterly blurs and hard edges. He also makes his own canvas. Here, if you can see, he stitches his own canvas with a combination of fabrics that he finds in the LA fashion district or during his everyday life, whether it's in the streets. So that's a unique aspect of the artist's works. And then to the left, we have Canadian-born artist Andy Dixon. He recently did a collaboration with Versace, which was extremely popular. Andy Dixon's works explore the themes of decadence, patronage, and the relationship between art and wealth. He uses common historical tropes to reimagine still life
and Odalisque paintings as an agency for desire. So when you first see this painting, you first, you know, kind of reference to those old master still life paintings. But here, of course, it's reinterpreted, reappropriated in the artist's terms. He uses pastels on top of paint as well here. And, you know, this even the way he draws the frames of these, you know, old master still life paintings and kind of reinterprets them in different colors, such as pink and turquoise, makes them stand out. And again, he also highlights, you know, what was important with still life during, you know, those times, which is, you know, being able to paint the different types of textures of all the objects, in which obviously he's kind of removed from here. Whether it's the curtains, the stainless steel, the skin of orange, and the velvet, and the ropes. But it's a very interesting take on his expression about our society's relationship to wealth. And then I will turn here to a painting by Camilla Engstorm. She is a Swedish artist who works in New York, a young artist. Her practice encompasses painting, drawing, sculpture, and poetry. She explores autobiographical topics through humor, surrealistic landscapes, and figurative expression. Here we see, you know, a close-up of a woman's body and a plate of fruit with milk set in a very simple background. We will be having a show with her here in Hong Kong later this year as well. Here in the corner, we have another American artist called Ryan Schneider, who lives and works from Joshua Tree in Los Angeles. He works with wood. Often he works in very large scale sculptures and installations. His hand carved wood sculptures are dreamy and often feature a very spiritually charged quality, portraying moments of tension, exhilaration, as entity that they're encountering in the real world. I guess that's it. His works are also, you know, held in many public and private collections worldwide. And then here in the last room, we have three artists. The first artist here is Adam Barris, often applying paint straight from the tube. Again, kind of exploring the traditional approach to painting. Adam Barris's sculptural materialization of solid colors and repetition of patterns bring forth human impulse of categorization and class systems to differentiate ourselves and our work. So the artist is trained, you know, as a painter, as an artist, but he deliberately removes the paint removes the paintbrush from his practice, and he works directly with the paint onto the canvas, which, you know, is very interesting. And here, you know, we can guess, you know, what the portrait or this head is inspired from. And then here on the left, we have another American.
Have we lost Juliana?
Hello?
Still there?
Yes, can you hear me? Hello? Can you hear me?
We've got a little bit of video lag.
Okay, hold on. Sorry. Hello, can you hear me? Hello.
Yep. Why don't you go ahead? Let's try to wrap up in the next couple minutes, 2 minutes or so. Thanks.
Yeah, so this is the last painting. So this is Aaron Johnson, and he paints. And so thank you for joining us again. We will always concurrently have two shows going on, downstairs and upstairs, now that we've expanded our space here in Hong Kong. If you have any questions, please, you know, feel free to reach us anytime. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Juliana. It was great to see. Last but certainly not least, we're switching over to White Cube. I believe we have a colleague in the gallery in Hong Kong. Is that right?
Hello.
So over to you, are you ready?
Hi. Okay, I think I'm just waiting for my college, and they are preparing the video.
Yeah, I'm already online. Ruyun, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Yes.
So, okay. So, first of all, I want to thank you, the Taipei Connection, to prepare all the program that our gallery have have a chance to introduce our current show in Hong Kong. But I think the most of audience, they is come from the Asia, so I Mandarin will be the most of the content in this introductions. 所以我这次会比较多是用中文去介绍我们这次在香港买地方的展览。那我。 我们其实在设计这个展览之下的时候，我可能需要先跟大家介绍一下我们白地方的一个初步的历史。其实大家可能都知道，我们在1993年的时候有我们的创始人 J. Jobling 在伦敦。然后，其实我们画廊从一开始的时候，其实只有4米乘4米的一个非常小的空间里面。那他在这个小空间里面呢，他去跟一位艺术家去做一个展览。 那这个整个计划其实已经执行了超过10年，那其实到现在我们可能白立方每年都会推出一些 Inside White Cube 的项目，其实就是延续我们创始人从一开始的时候他去规划这种一系列年轻还有具实验的一个展示。然后其实大家可能在早期的90跟00年代的时候对。 英国的YBA的艺术家会开始耳熟能详，那有一部分原因可能也是因为我们画廊其实在跟这些艺术家，包含了 Damien Hirst 或是崔杰敏，我们做了很多很有实验性，然后很前卫的展览。那从那之后，其实白立方这30几年的发展，我们开始去更多去布及到全球范围的艺术家。 那我们的伦敦总部在伦敦，我们有两个地点，然后一个是我们的总部 Mason Yard， 还有一个就是在Royal Academy 皇家艺术学院对面的 Bermondsey 空间。那我们这次的话，因为疫情的关系，所以我们这次是主要是介绍我们香港的展览。那我们香港白立方是从2012年成立，然后由我们的总监 Laura。 然后去主持所有的 program， 那这次这个展览，我们其实整个香港团队每个人都有参与。那我们把这个展览比较去把它设定成是一个项目，然后我们提出了一个概念叫做 encounter 邂逅。这个部分来讲的话，我们希望这个展览不需要有太多的严肃的一些论点或是。 因为它毕竟不是一个艺术家的一个个展， 那这里面当然是包含了我们所有的合作跟代理艺术家的一些新的新作，然后还有一些他们长期的实践。那现在我的香港同事，其实他现在我们在镜头上面其实你应该可以看到Anthony Gormley 的作品。那为什么我们会由这一件作品开始呢？刚才提到的邂逅，那其实邂逅这个展览我们规划了两个部分。那一开始我们觉得我们跟艺术，比如说像包含今天的台北 Connection， 我们跟线上的观众，我们跟所有喜爱艺术的人，我们跟业内的工作者，我们对于艺术它其实也是连接我们在一起，但是有一部分来讲它其实也会是我们个人与艺术家之间的邂逅，或者是说艺术与艺术家，作品与作品之间的一个观看的方式。那这个比较广义的语境之下，其实我们希望它会有一个可能出乎大家意料之外的体验。所以这里面就我刚才提到为什么我们香港同事所有同事都有进去参与，其实我们也各自提出我们觉得对于哪些艺术家他之间的关系我们会觉得特别有趣的，我们会在这次的第一部分也会有一些展示。那我觉得大家可能对Anthony Gormley 其实已经比较熟悉的，那当然包含他去年在英国皇家艺术学院有一个大型的个展。那这件作品是他主要，等会我们也会看到他主要系列，但是这件作品其实有点像是 Anthony 他在把等于说他对望着，因为大家可能来过白立方香港的话会知道我们其实面对了马路，然后过去会是四季酒店跟香港的车站，那其实它就是一个面向窗口。那这种面向窗口的不期而遇，或者是说往外的行人，或是想要来我们白立方看的人，他可能在经过的一瞬间他就会跟这件作品产生一个连接。那我们觉得这种比较轻松的状态其实就可以用这样的体验去看我们这次的展览。所以其实我们在第一个入口一进来的最大的展厅里面还有其他的艺术家可以请我同事可以去整个展场去有一个这是公里的纸本作品，然后还有包含了他在去年我们伦敦空间的一个新的系列大型个展，然后从这边你还会看到墙面上也有我们另外一个代理合作的重要艺术家 Anson Kiefer 的新作。那这两位艺术家在去年都分别在我们的伦敦空间推出了大型的个展。那为什么我们会在入口一进来的时候会去用这两个艺术家跟大家去进行第一个邂逅对话的原因，就是说其实我们觉得某一些不一定是男性或者是有历史痕迹去，因为大家对于 Anson Kiefer 的理解可能就在于他对于东西德解严之后的合并，然后还有他所看到的一些纳粹文化，然后断言残命，那他这里面他又有运用了很多古代的希腊北欧的神话，然后去融合在他的作品里面。那这样的一个比较广大的一个命题之下，其实我们提出了一个概念，就是说我们是不是在这个土地上，就是在地球这个土地上，我们其实跟地球是产生一个共生。那为什么我们会在第一个展间去说的原因，就是说因为我们觉得其实 Kiefer 他是用一个比较谦卑的概念，他是去看这整个世界，所以包含我们从这件作品去进到他其实最新的个展超弦系列超弦理论。那超弦理论其实也在解答就是整个宇宙这边的数学的答案，数学的命题。那也很多人会说为什么 Kiefer 开始去找寻做庞大的一个答案，其实我觉得他们可能不一定是 Kiefer 不一定，然后 Anson Kiefer 跟 Anthony Gormley 他们不一定是真的需要知道或是解决某一个艺术问题，而是说他们去用人这个容器，人这个视角，人这个文化去看这个世界，或者是去理解这个世界。 这个也是 Anthony Gomedy 近期的作品，然后他其实这个也跟宇宙整个空间有关。那好玩的是说他这个纸本的作品其实是用中国的水墨的形式，那包含了我们在地面上你应该可以看到我们刚才有一闪而过的 Pack， 对，这件作品，这件作品在这次的我们的线上展厅我们也有把它展示。其实人这个人就像刚才 Ansep Keeper 他是用他的文化历史特征去介入整个世界，那其实 Anthony Gomedy 他的人去进入这个环境或是自然，他觉得人只是他其中一个容器而已。那我们现在所处的社会其实已经极度的碎片化，为什么？就包含我们现在用线上展厅在看展览，我们没有用肉身去进去，数位化、讯息化、资讯化，而且这是快速流动的状态之下，它的很多的一个不稳定性跟一个切割点，其实就跟人这个容器它有出现了一个抽象的变化。所以我们如果用这种方式去看Anthony Gomedy 的时候，其实在这样状态就知道说他为什么把自己是放在一个共生，或者是说我们觉得它是一个很谦卑的东西去看这个世界。所以其实某一些艺术家他在寻找艺术问题之下或是之后的时候，他其实会去得到一些更放松或更自然的一种处事方格。所以其实我们在大家也可以关注我们白立方的微信，那我们微信其实有一系列是针对这次展览的一个相关的文章。那我们的在这次里面我们会觉得说哎，可以，就是在第一展厅之下的状态之下，它其实就是一个共生，然后很诗意，然后很放松的。那这里面当然也会有艺术家平常贯彻的一些张力跟紧张感。那我们可以看再回来看 Anthony Gomedy 不好意思，再回来看 Keeper 这一件作品。对，那其实大家会想说为什么中间有一座好像山，然后好像茅草堆，然后好像有一个斧头。其实它这个是用一个希腊神话叫做戈尔迪之结的一个神话，它去做一个寓意，就是说亚历山大帝他到达了希腊神庙，然后他们就是发现一个绳子很难解开嘛，无法解答，那他只是用一个斧头就是把这个绳子直接劈断了。所以其实这就是某一种可能解决方式的东西，你不需要去纠结这个原因，或是你到后来你只要有一个勇敢或是果决或是一个放松的方式，你去把它劈断，那这个是整个世界或许就已经豁然开朗。那这种开放性的暗示，我们觉得在Anthony Gomedy 很多的实践里面其实你也会看到。所以我们在第一展厅的邂逅，这是我们画廊提出的一个新的视角，希望在所有未来有机会到达我们香港空间去看这两位艺术家的作品的时候，其实你可能可以用自己的一个方式去理解他们。好，然后我们第一展厅入口进来的话就是这两位艺术家的邂逅，那我们再往楼上去走。所以其实我们不只是在把艺术家的观念还有艺术家的时空上面我们去做一个交替跟打杂，那我们也希望我们这个展览跟香港的当下一个土地也会产生关系。所以在大家看到是说，那这个邂逅的层次它就会更有实验性，那我们希望这个实验其实也跟我们创始人在做一个关于整个艺术的一个重新的提出一个观念，会是给大家有一个新的一个审视的机会。所以我们从楼梯上来，这件作品是 Sarah Morris。那我们可以先看我们第二展间我们的一个层次的展现。所以其实我们在某种算是巧合也算是某种刻意的状态之下，其实第二展间全部都是女性的艺术家。那 从我们一进来看到的 Sarah Morris， 然后跟我们现在右面看到的 Dora Muller，这两个艺术家其实我们也提出了一个可能很好或是有趣的邂逅可以给大家提供参考。那Sarah Morris 其实大家亚洲观众可能对他反而会比 Dora Muller 更熟悉，因为他其实2018年在 UCCA 做过了一个大型的个展，那个里面其实他很多去讨论比如说视觉文化，然后声音，然后节奏轮廓的之间的一个关系。那 Sarah Morris 他的跟 Dora Muller 最不一样的地方就是说，他其实是广泛的去游览这整个世界，他去寻找这个世界不一样的变化或者是线索，包含了现在就是我们可以回到右手边那面墙。对，但这一件作品呢叫做费米实验室，其实他讲的就是那个美国的那个关于粒子的一个实验室，然后他在研究那个费米，美国费米这个实验室，他去研究关于科学的东西。但这个实验室其实里面很多的，他也有关于艺术的一个融合。那 Sarah Morris 他就是把这整个算是一个空间的概念，或是一个动态的一个东西，他把它回到一个平面的视觉。所以其实你会发现说，他其实就算背后有很多的一个层次的意义，但是他回到一个更简洁的一个减法。那他用这种减法的方式，他去呈现一个抽象、一个平面、一个没有声音、没有影像、没有三维空间的一个停留。那所以你用这种方式去观看 Sarah Morris 的一个研究，或是从他后面去看到一个背后的一个涵养，其实这一块是很有趣而且很冲突的。那他跟 Dora Muller 为什么我们会把他提出来？那 Dora Muller 其实他是苏联时代，就是那时候美国跟苏联时代冷战时期，他是在这个时期长大的匈牙利艺术家。那在一个1970-80年代的时候 ，Dora Muller 在一个政治跟这个的文化背景之下，他其实更多是关于自己个人的意志还有实验的一个倾向。所以其实他在家里的时候他在他的家里，他把一个类似于铝板或者是金属板层面的东西，他去做一个抛接或位移。他在这样的瞬间的一个状态，他发现他视觉在这上面的动态的平移或是扭曲的并行，他感到很有有趣，而且他觉得这样子的一个视觉眼睛眼珠的一个状态，他怎么去让他在平面的桌面上去做一个呈现。那您可以看到，大家可以看到最右边的作品，就是我们看到右边这一件，这是我们举例，因为这件紫色的中间的不好意思，中间这一件。这件作品我们在这次的 Online Viewing Room 我们也有展出。那它就是很像一个薄薄的一个黄色的一个我们可能说它是一个变形后的空间，或者是一个平面东西，它类似于折曲，然后折曲在落在一个紫色的一个变形空间之上。那这样子的一个状态，它其实呈现中一种还是具有一个动感的一个动态的一个力量的一种隐喻。所以其实我们在看 Dora 的时候，我们会觉得它好像在我们的眼珠里面，它会有一些一直在闪动的感觉，我们会觉得说它好像是一个有点类似于装置作品。然后呢，那它这样东西的形成就在于，就是刚才我们现在同时在录音里面在看到它各式各样的色块之间的铺陈，然后还有交替。那这种动态位移，然后会有一种视觉的一种残像残留的一个游戏，其实它就跟Sarah Morris 他会用一个可能程式影像音乐，他去取用的一个跳动感，然后他又回归到一个架上作品的时候，他们两个这个之间的联系，其实我们会觉得这是很有趣的。虽然他们两个属于不同时代跟不同文化背景， 但是我们觉得说在艺术家他在实验某一些一些艺术或是一些二维或三维之间的命题的时候，但这个背景之下其实去理解他们反而很有趣。那这两个艺术家其实对于音乐他们都会有很深的理解或是感受。那我为什么会提到关于音乐，是因为在这个展间里面其实我们就可以把这个连到了不管是Virginia Overton 或是可以在更大的展间去看我们其他在这个展间里面的作品。地面上这个艺术家是 Virginia Overton， 然后后面的话是那个 Beatrice Melazas。 那这两位艺术家其实他们一个是来自于美国，一个来自于巴西，那当然年龄层其实 也完全不一样。那 Virginia Overton 他这次会在今年，如果一切时间还有疫情控制得宜的状态之下，我们很希望他可以今年在我们香港空间举办个展。那Beatrice 其实他也在准备他的一个亚洲的一个大型个展，那但我们希望一切都可以疫情可以一切顺利的结束。那这两个之间他们其实也有关于拼贴，然后他们也有颜色错移，然后也有跳跃，那只是说他们使用的媒材的转化的方式也是不一样的。像我们地面上你看到 Virginia Overton， 他其实很多他也来自于建筑材料，或是他也有他自己放了一个纪念，他去扭曲整个我们所说的白盒子空间的一个视觉措施。那这个其实就会说为什么会跟东方明珠好玩的地方在这。那这里面它还是会有一些拼贴跟一个视觉的一个暂留暂存，然后它也有它的跳动感。那这个部分其实在这个展间里面我们觉得在不管是你从视觉上去看，还是说你用各个比如说艺术层面或是文学层面还是各项层面你再去看，或是建筑层面或是现在建筑的层面去，现在社会的建筑形式、建筑材料，然后建筑的形状，我们再去看这些艺术家去使用的元素，其实就会很好玩。那我提到这个使用形状，是因为我们背后这一件 Beatrice 这一件，其实它很多的，因为它来自于巴西，其实它很多的色彩拼贴，然后它为什么会有这种丰富的层次或是热情，其实都跟这个它背后所生长的文化其实也有关。那有一些可能是来自于商品的包装糖果的包装，或是各式各样的一种他们在文化里面会重复出现一些色彩。那这是他所看到的世界，其实就会跟我们其他比如说我们刚刚看到的英国或欧洲的世界其实就不太一样。所以在颜色上也会反映出他们文化的不同。那这里面的一些视觉跟重叠，其实他也是在玩一个玩一些很有趣的视觉游戏。那这个视觉游戏其实也会跟Dora 还有 Stella Morris 会有一些很好玩的一些视觉上的连接点。那当然中间 Virginia Overton 他反而在把这整个空间又变成好像他自己的一个作品，然后把这我们所看到在墙面上的所有的艺术家好像都变成他作品的一部分。所以在这个反光里面去照到那个周丽的作品，其实就会让我们觉得特别有趣。其实周丽的画作里面他有些都是来自于心源，他有时候比如说是他在工作室他去看窗外，或是说他在自己的个人情感去看这整个世界。就是我为什么我会这样说的原因，是因为其实他比较多是用他自己的内在的消化，然后他去理解这个世界，所以里面有很多关于他个人的故事，他家庭的故事，他的父母的故事，还有他小孩。那周丽的话中国大陆的观众可能会有印象，就是他在余德耀的个展，然后他所提出的我们说的东方式的中式书写、中式抒情，然后我们对于心的缘，然后桃花源的一个向往，那这里面其实他很多都是属于比较东方式的禅意吧，我们可能是可以这样觉得。 那这种律动感、跳动感跟这个阴影的变化，很多的瞬间的转换都来自于他的心理当下对于这个世界的感受，所以你很难去用一个具体的方式去具体的故事去背后去诉说这件画作有的涵养，但是他的一个东方书写跟他的跳动感跟他的蓝色去象征一个永恒的存在，其实这种形而上的一种精神方式就会让我们去提出，就是可以去看看 Ethel Allen。 所以为什么我们旁边会放入了 Ethel Allen？ 那这位美籍黎巴嫩裔的艺术家，其实他可能早期大家对他的熟悉是来自于他的写作跟他的著作。那他在绘画这个部分来讲，它很多是关于抽象的景色，那它对于抽象绘画的景色的转化都是来自于它自己对于这个世界的变化，所以它其实这个心理艺术家的心理世界，其实你可以跟为什么周黎会这样去做一个变化。但是好玩就是说，这个是西方跟东方会用不一样的方式去做一个阐释。为什么我现在会在这个时候提出东方跟西方，是因为我们等一下在第三展间的部分会有更多在这个部分的一个融合吧。所以在这个展间里面，就会跟楼下我们刚刚一进来去看到Kiefer 然后 Anthony Gomez 会呈现一个不一样的气质。那这种邂逅的方式，艺术家跟艺术家之间不一样的作品视觉媒材，然后节奏，但这些的关系，那我们这个部分就是希望，非常希望观众有机会的话，可以到我们香港的现场来看。那当然，如果有其他的问题，也可以在我们的微信或是在我们的 FB 这边去可以跟我们提出，我们都会跟你更多解答。那当然，情况如果 OK 的话，东方穆勒也会今年或是明年会在我们香港空间会有个展。好，然后我们从这边进到我们第三个展区。
我要稍微停一下 video 哦。
好，那我们第三展区，那当然也是巧妙或者是刻意或是巧合之下我们会是全英国的艺术家。那大家对于白立方的一个理解，会说我们可能很多是关于英国艺术的一个发展。那我们在这里面我们相对更放松，所以你们看到现在目前看到是三位英国艺术家，然后包含了悬吊的这件Caris Wet Event， 然后跟你后面看到 Real Feeling 的 Adipic， 然后跟左边的 Darren Allen。 那我觉得我们在这个展间里面可以给观众去做一个巧妙的提示，是说其实在 Caris 跟 Darren Allen 这两件作品里面背后都有关于东方文化的涉猎。像我们看到右手边悬吊的这一件，它其实就是来自于一本散文集。那大家可不可以想说，那散文文字跟这个吊灯会有什么关系？那其实如果大家来有机会看到他的个展，因为他其实预计也是今年或是明年会在上海的复兴美术馆会有一个大型个展。他很多里面，他其实他的你们所看到的装置，它都是动态的。他这里面的灯光，然后或者是有一些作品，它背景会有一些音乐的一些讯息。其实很多都是跟他的作品的一个节奏会有声音，然后会有视觉，然后会有悬吊，然后会有灯光的一个变化。那这件作品叫做《音译礼赞》，那其实这个是来自于日本的那个谷崎润一郎的散文集。那他把这个散文他去念这个文字东西，去转化成一个音乐的节奏。然后这个音乐的节奏，它会出现一个，它去套用在你现在看到我们灯上面，它会有一个明闪明闪明闪，这种明闪状态其实就是那个音乐节奏，所以它这个其实是一个二次或三次的一个转化。那我们觉得在这种状态之下，也跟我们刚才在一楼所提到的关于诗意， 关于文学的一个东西，以台湾的人的文学。其实这些东西可能大家会在看这个展览里面会有更丰富的一个视觉或是感受可以去看。那它对面这一件 Darium 也是来自于日本的意象。然后Darium 在这里面它也有放入它所说的节奏。其实你们会看到它有说什么二啊零啊，有种数字的碎片，其实它很多都是是来自于有点像我们早期在车站我们所看到的那种时刻的一个那个叫什么跳动的时钟，它会有一个快速流转时间的一种节奏性。那在它的其实在它的个展里面，它有另外一件作品，就是一整排的关于那个时钟的跳转。所以这种节奏啪啪啪啪啪，我们可能我们现代人就会去肉身的，我们可以去想象出来这种节奏感。那他在这种节奏感之下，他去融入了日本版画的一位艺术家吉田富的雨中的夜莺，这件作品是也叫雨中夜莺。那他在夜莺里面，他去看到他那个洒落的那个意象，他只是把那个意象把它去抽取，然后跟他的他对于时间的理解去做一个融合。所以其实这个东西会当你在场内的时候，你去看到这个时间的一个变化跟洒落的时候，其实在右手边我们在看一个 Caris 的作品的时候，它其实就会有一个呼应。
Thank you very much, Yuen. That's really a fantastic walkthrough of the gallery. It's a very broad and in-depth look at your program that you have on. I really appreciate being able to see a bit from so many different artists at the same time. Kind of makes
Thank you.
To get there in person. Because we need to get set up for our next event later this afternoon, we are needing to wrap this one up. Thank you very much to all of our guests at White Cube Over the Influence and Alison Fine Arts, as well as everyone who joined us online this afternoon. We will be back in the same place in about 2 hours at 5:30 p.m. Looking at Erwin Verm's exhibition at the Taipei Fine Arts Museum. So please feel free to join us then. The artist will be online, as will the curator, Jerome Sanz. So I look forward to seeing everybody again very soon. Thanks and have a good afternoon.